All right, welcome back, everyone. I'm really excited to have reached our fourth speaker, Dr. Harry Cooper. So let me say a few words of introduction for Harry. Harry Cooper is the head of the Department of Modern and Contemporary Art at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. He earned his PhD from Harvard in 1997 with a dissertation on the paintings of Piet Mondrian. Cooper was a curator at the Harvard Art Museums for a decade before joining the National Gallery in 2008. He has organized or co-organized exhibitions on the work of Mondrian, Medardo Rosso, Frank Stella, and others. And Harry, you didn't include this in your bio, but I wanted to add that along with Barbara Haskell of the Whitney Museum of American Art, he co-curated the 2016-17 retrospective, Stuart Davis in Full Swing, which was a terrific exhibition, and swing landscape was prominently featured in that show. His current project, a touring Philip Guston retrospective, will open at the MFA Boston on May 1st. And recent publications include Decoding Juan Gris, which is an essay for the exhibition organized by the Dallas and Baltimore Art Museums, and Parallel Processing for an exhibition of Oliver Jackson's work at the St. Louis Art Museum. And I'll turn it over to you now, Harry.
Thank you, Jenny. It's great to be here. And thank you so much for inviting me and bringing us all together. It's an honor. I will echo what everybody has said about this distinguished audience, so many familiar faces and names in the field. And as usual, I feel like a bit of an interloper. I'm not an Americanist. I'm not a muralist or muralismist. But I have worked on a number of artists like Guston and Gorky and Davis. I can't believe I left that out of my bio. who were muralists, or Mondrian, for that matter. If we think about what he did with the walls of his own studio, as well as some plans for interior designs of entire rooms. So. But that said, I will plunge ahead, and my credentials involve more jazz, which I'm a great fan of, and modernism in general, and that all those cross currents that everybody's been talking about between Europe and America. I thought maybe I would start, since I think there's time, by trying to play a little music, if that sounds good. And I'm not sure how this will work, but I'm going to try to play Louis Armstrong's Save It Pretty Mama from 1928. It's about 3 minutes, and pay special attention to the Earl Hines piano solo, which Davis loved. It was one of his revelations. So here goes nothing. Thank you.
pretty mama, day by day, please, honey, don't get none away. Let it pile up on you, and if you say, I'll be around soon to spend the day. I have an art of loving that can be true. My way of hugging is a treat. I know we can agree. Go save it, pretty mama. Save it all for me.
Okay, I was going to stop it early, but I just couldn't bring myself to fade it out. So I'll share my screen and get to work. Oops. Okay, hope everybody can see that. And just get my text up here. So you know this painting. I'm going to pose two questions. Why was Swing Landscape, one of the greatest works of American public art, never shown in its intended place, its public venue, the Williamsburg Houses? And that's something that Jenny addresses, of course, in the catalog. And a question Jenny was just asking, what does the word swing signify in Davis's title? I'll start with the first, which has gotten more attention, and then I'll move to the second, which has gotten less attention, but I think they're related. There's no existing documentation of the rejection of the painting, so we can only speculate. The painter Carl Holte offered a theory in 1964, just months after Davis's death, and this is quoted in the chronology of the catalog. And I had never come across this. Very interesting. I think that Stuart Davis painted something with willful intent not to have it go where it was to go. I remember we would hear around the studios that if a thing was too good, it wasn't good enough. Now, Davis's picture was certainly the kind of picture that was too good to hang in the hallway of a new housing project. Actually, it was going to be a community room, as we know, and too loud, visually too loud, and it was never put up there, unquote. This suggestion that Davis set out to make a painting that would be rejected seems, quote, far-fetched, as Jenny notes in the catalog. Indeed, it's hard to imagine that an artist so committed to bringing modern art to the people would be that perverse. As Davis wrote in his statement on the project, the government has made a start in bringing this abstract art directly to the people, unquote. Still, we can't dismiss Carl Holte. He was not only very close to Davis, he was also close to Mondrian, and in fact, he helped bring Mondrian to the US in 1940. He had met both Mondrian and Davis in Europe. Holte was that rare figure with a foot in both camps, Davis's abstracted realism and Mondrian's pure abstraction. Holte's report that modern painters felt ambivalent about working within the limits of a public project, even when they were dependent on it for income, rings true. So even if Davis did not exactly intend to fail, he probably enjoyed pushing the limits. Jenny proposes that the painting was rejected because it didn't comport with the, quote, streamlined geometric aesthetic, unquote, of the project, nor did several of the other works proposed by the original 12 artists. She points out that the four artists whose work made it onto the walls, Bolotovsky, Green, Swindon, and Kelpie, quote, were all affiliated with the AAA, American Abstract Artist Group, and their work was essentially non-objective in character. And we've seen all of those examples. But Davis's refusal of pure abstraction, his retention of landscape elements, was not the only problem. Let's listen to Holte's exact words. The painting was too loud, visually too loud. Notice this synesthetic word choice, which seems appropriate to the music Davis loved, the music that he honored in the title of the painting. And I noticed that Greta mentioned synesthesia, so maybe we can talk about that. So this brings me to my second question about the word swing. Davis worked on the painting, as we know, from 1936 to 1938, the very height of the swing era, the period generally thought of from 1930 to 1945, when big bands toured the country and their radio broadcasts were ubiquitous. String was enshrined as the pinnacle of jazz at the end of 1938 by those concerts that Jody mentioned, the famous From Spirituals to Swing concert produced by John Hammond at Carnegie Hall in December of 1938, which featured Count Basie, Benny Goodman, and some of the most famous blues and boogie-woogie musicians of the day. The concert was also a landmark in the political and social history of jazz. Sorry to be repeating a little bit here. For its example of racial integration, both on stage and in the audience, as well as its sponsorship by leftist and communist groups. Davis, a leftist and ardent supporter of civil rights, workers' rights, and artists' rights, would have approved of these politics. Although he quit the American Artists Congress in April 1940 over its endorsement of the Soviet war against Finland, in 1938, he was still very much engaged. In fact, its president, and even though he retreated from political activity, as did a lot of people after 1940, he certainly maintained his values, especially when it came to civil rights. Swing was the pop music of the day. And just like rock and roll, a quarter century later, it was criticized for being too loud. The musician and historian Gunther Schuller, in his definitive and opinionated history, The Swing Era, often upbraids bands that went for sheer volume and in the process obscured the subtler aspects of sound and syncopation. The association of swing with loudness might have influenced New York Times critic Edward Alden Jewell in his 1938 review of Swing Landscape, when he wrote that Davis was, quote, making the easel scream, unquote, and then concluded that it deserves its own or an entire housing project. We're going to learn some of these quotes by memory before the day is over. Maybe Carl Holte was making the same association, talking about the loudness of the painting. In any case, this was not a work, the work we're seeing on the screen, that would have played nicely with the muted elegance of the approved murals. Jenny writes in the catalog, the murals that ended up on the walls of the Williamsburg houses were decorative panels that supported architect William Liskay's wish for a painted complement to his architectural design, and that Matt Diller, Burgoyne Diller, head of the mural division of the FAP, met Diller's desire to create a restful, harmonious environment, unquote. No screaming allowed. So if we look at the various studies for Swing Landscape, we can see how Davis turned up the volume, so to speak, in the finished work. He added visual details, stripes and dots, ladders and rigging that keep the eye stimulated. We can see this most clearly by comparing the oil study in the National Gallery collection, a work we recently inherited from the Corcoran, with the finished work. So here is the study. And the miracle of PowerPoint is that we can go back and forth. And in fact, what I've done next, this study was cut down. So it's only a study for the left, about 2/3 of the painting. So I cut down the painting here so we can go back and forth and see just what he changed, how much he added, all that candy cane striping, intensification of color, but staying very true to the basic structure. So that's one kind of change. Second, Davis made the background color more and more intense, bringing it up to the surface so the eye had nowhere to rest or escape. Here in the gouache study of 1936 at the Sheldon Museum, the first study, a pleasant pink weaves its way through the painting from the sky at top left to the foreground at bottom left and right. The other background color, a bright yellow at upper right, is more assertive, but still remains behind the other elements, backing them up. In this 1937 gouache at the Smithsonian, Davis has settled on a single beige color for both the foreground strip of the dock and the background strip of sky. The effect is disturbing and flattening, turning the central parade of forms into a kind of frieze that unscrolls across a flat ground or almost across a page. But the feeling of a background is restored in the left third of the picture by Davis's use of a pale gray behind that ship, house and buoy. In the final painting, that gray has become a royal blue and refuses to stay in the background. The top and bottom strips have become a fairly bright white that pokes holes in the picture by linking up with other white shapes throughout the central zone. The result is a visual dazzle, a complication that tends to disguise the three-part structure of the whole. And no doubt this is why Davis produced this work, a line version of the composition to show its structure. And I think it's really remarkable that when we take away all the color and pattern, we can see quite a clear structure of a foreground strip representing the dock with kind of cubic or prismatic objects on it. And then most of the picture, it consists of these sort of stage flats almost. I can move my cursor if you can see it. There's one here, sort of for this left third of the painting. And there's this central one here, which connects up to one on the right. The central one is somewhat truncated here, allowing for this central aspect of sky and rope. So it's actually a fairly traditional and symmetrical composition. If we can use those words for such an apparent jumble of forms. And then there's the strip of sky sort of here at the top. It's interesting that he signed and dated this, and later in his career in the 50s, he would often do black line versions, or fairly often do black line versions of finished paintings. I think this is the first one that could qualify as that sort of black line version where he's looking purely at structure. One of my favorite studies in the catalog, and I never knew this one, is a small pencil sketch for the right third of the composition. Interestingly, this is for the section that was cut off of the National Gallery study. I wonder if maybe this was a section that gave him trouble. It's maybe one of the least clear sections. It's the section that Jody showed us next to the Lindy Hoppers. this reminds me, this section reminds me of what Davis wrote in his brief 1945 autobiography about what he called the architectural beauties of the Gloucester schooner, which he had admired as early as 1915, yeah, one of his first of many summers in Gloucester. He wrote, quote, "Its masts define the often empty sky expanse. They make it possible for the novice landscape painter to evade the dangers of taking off into the void. From the masts of the schooners, the artist eventually learns to invent his own coordinates," unquote. So he loved the way that this complicated equipment in the sky gave the artist something to work with. And in the sketch, we see Davis using some dotted lines here, something he often did in sketches, a kind of schematism to plot out a spatial system of his own devising. And the keynote of that system seems to be a kind of horror vacui. Everything should be filled, should be defined, should be determined, to use a Mondrian word. The work is full. It's tempting to conclude that Davis, in making swing landscape so loud, so bright, busy, and dazzling, was not just testing the aesthetic of the Williamsburg project, he was making a painting for the swing era that was swirling all around him. Or was he? There's a problem with the idea of swing landscape as the quintessential swing era painting. I can advance here. Not yet. Davis was not a particular fan of the big bands. He does not seem to have attended either of the Spirituals to Swing concerts. And I'm not positive, but I looked through the desk calendars that he kept, which are in his son Earl's possession. I looked through years ago all the papers at Harvard. Didn't see any evidence of it. I mean, he might not have been able to afford a ticket. He was extremely poor, living in a third floor walk-up cold water flat. He was pretty good alcoholic and already having health problems. But I wonder that maybe the names of Basie and Goodman did not attract him particularly. Jody showed us some of the history of Davis's jazz taste. His first jazz epiphany came with visits to black saloons and barrel houses in New Jersey and Harlem in the teens, where he heard blues and ragtime. And Jody showed us one of those drawings for the New Masses, showing a pianist and then a large portrait of a black male figure in the foreground. In fact, that was discussed in the New Masses as a possible caricature, a possible negative caricature. Davis defended it against that. Davis credited this experience, what he called the numerical precisions of the Negro piano players, as much as the 1913 Armory Show with making him a modern artist. The second epiphany came during his 1928 to 29 year in Paris, where a fellow American, an expat, played him his first Earl Hines record. That's the record that we heard before I started talking. Davis later wrote that Hines is playing, quote, "served me as proof that art can exist since 1928 when I heard his playing in a Louis Armstrong record, Save It, Pretty Mama," unquote. And the piano, of course, was Davis's own instrument. He played it pretty well as a young man. So we've got Earl Hines and Barrel House piano players and Duke Ellington. So by 1932, Davis was enthralled to another pianist, Duke Ellington. When Davis was asked in 32 to submit a painting to the first Whitney Biennial, he produced American Painting Here, which included concluded the sentence, it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing that Jody also showed us. The reference was topical. Ellington's hit record of that name had been recorded in February 1932, just 3 months before the biennial was announced. If we have time at the end, I'll play you that record too. A decade later, Davis had one of the great thrills of his life when Ellington played at the opening of his 1943 show at Edith Halpert's Downtown Gallery. What I suspect caught Davis's ear in this 1932 recording, which became so iconic, partly because of the title, it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing, was the singing of Ivy Anderson, who was one of the first female vocalists to dare the kind of vocal inventions that Louis Armstrong pioneered. She was one of the first scat singers, female scat singers on this record. In the nonsense syllables and neologisms of scat singing, I think Davis found the model of a language midway between recognition and abstraction. As he said of Armstrong, quote, "He even sings the silly lyrics, but he interpolates new words, leaves out others, and the silly lyric becomes real poetry," unquote. I think it is no accident that American Painting was the first work in which Davis developed what would literally become his signature, a thick, angular, cursive script that he used to write the lyrics vertically along that left edge of the painting. In the subsequent campaigns on this painting, and you can see it's dated 1932, 1942, 1954, especially in that central sort of plum-colored hexagon, the script, that's the latest edition, the script becomes less legible, more like scat singing. And then I guess he had overworked that painting enough and he decided to start fresh in 1956 with this painting at the Hirshhorn Tropes de Teens. And again, we can toggle back and forth and enjoy what Davis did to the same basic composition. With all this talk of Ellington, I can imagine an objection to where my argument is going. Wasn't the Ellington Orchestra a mainstay of the swing era? So isn't American Painting, or swing landscape for that matter, a swing era painting? Yes and no. The Ellington Band had more nuance than any of the other swing bands. It certainly could be as loud and danceable as Basie or Goodman or many others, but it had more range. Davis was a listener, not a dancer. He reportedly tried to dance during his Paris trip, but it wasn't for him. As he noted in his 1952 journal, quote, "Louis and Earl play dance music, but in doing it, they invent new arabesques of tonal intervals as they go along. The public," and you can hear the disdain here, "the public is not moved by this, except as it refers to their dance," unquote. That word arabesque is the perfect word for these cursive improvisations in the middle of American Painting or Tropes de Teens. It's time to say something obvious, but worth saying, which is that the word swing, whether it appears in the title of Swing Landscape or on the border of American Painting, does not just or necessarily refer to the swing era. The word had been used for a long time to define one of the basic characteristics of African-American popular music. It was published as early as 1903 by Will Marion Cook, a pioneering Black composer and major influence on Ellington, in his song Swing Along, composed in 1912, recorded composed in 1903 and then published music publishing 1912 and then recorded in 1918, one of the very early recordings. So what is swing? Very hard to define. I think Louis Armstrong said, you know, if you have to ask, you don't know what it is. So it's not just a matter of syncopation, which actually can be very square It has to do more with a flowing, swaying, rocking beat, maybe a relaxed rhythmic drive, the kind of thing you want to snap your fingers to. And as I'm saying these words, oh, here, by the way, we saw this already, Duke and Stuart. So as I'm trying to define swing, I want to look again at swing landscape, which is full of rhythmic marks that are never repetitive or mechanical, full of verticals and horizontals that are never quite square to the edges of the canvas. Like the boats in the Gloucester Harbor, the painting sways and swings. My point is fairly simple. The idea that swing landscape is a loud painting, while it has some truth to it, is not a satisfying account. It is even, I think, a misleading account. And we should remember that quote earlier, Davis saying that you know, for someone who's experienced the radio or the automobile, you don't hear things the same way. I don't think this painting was especially a loud painting to Davis. More helpful is the broader idea of swing, not just as a loud dance music, but as a basic rhythmic principle throughout the history of jazz. And that's not all. Rather than see the packed nature of so many of Davis's compositions as a kind of visual volume or noise, I think it's more interesting to connect this fullness to Davis's pursuit of abstraction, his attack on the figure as a center of interest standing out against a background. As his work developed, his theory went more and more in this direction. In 1943, he wrote, quote, "Instead of a center of focus, all parts of the field of observation are centers of focus, serial centers. The keynote of the total quality, the drama, is equality," unquote. This is the kind of thinking that swing landscape anticipates by about 5 years, and it is in turn what makes Davis a precursor of Jackson Pollock. And this comparison has often been made here. Pollock standing in front of his mural, so-called mural, 1943, that he made for the front hall of Peggy Guggenheim's apartment. Not sure that, has this ever been seen together with swing landscape? Did they both go to Paris? I don't think so, for that show about visual music. I won't make the argument, but you know, there are similarities and differences. The Pollock is clearly much more repetitive, but there's that same equally intense all over frieze-like movement. In a perfectly parallel way, Davis interpreted the jazz that he admired as working to destroy and reconfigure lyrics, sentiment, even melody itself, just as he is attacking the idea of a single center or figure in a composition. Paraphrasing Dizzy Gillespie in 1952, he wrote, quote, "As any jazz musician knows, a man with ideas doesn't waste them on a melody," unquote. The key was to transform the melody, the figure, the motif, the Gloucester schooner, into a set of satisfying formal relations, what he called new arabesques of tonal intervals. And the method for doing this, as Davis described it, resembled improvisation. In 1939, the year after completing Swing Landscape, he articulated this inductive improvisational method of working. Quote, "In composing a picture, each step of development is dependent on visualization of a specific set of directions, sizes, shapes, and tones, which represent a new object. This visualization is then related visually to the already existing object." So a call and response, a back and forth development with what's already on the canvas and what's going to be on the canvas. "The super space shapes develop inductively in this way," unquote. Or as he put it a little differently, reflecting his adoption of Gestalt psychology around 1941, quote, "If the part undergoes change in the development of the painting, it will do so only as new parts enter the field and multiply its meaning by multiplication of its relations," unquote. Davis can be a little dense. Thankfully, sometimes he says things much more plainly. Here from 1948, The old idea of the statically complete picture is eliminated by the new concept of the painting as a record of fresh day-by-day creative decisions, unquote. It's these day-to-day creative decisions that we see in the evolving campaign around swing landscape, which is so beautifully set out in the exhibition and the catalog with all those studies. But also throughout his career, and especially in a series of Gloucester-based works. And I'll give you just a quick look at Gloucester here. A photograph of the schooners, which were kind of antiques by this time, but they were still hanging around. And one of Davis's early sketches in 1931 in the exhibition. And then a series of works that he developed from those sketches. This is something that Barbara Askell and I, one of the several series that we were very happy to put together in the exhibition about 6 years ago. So here from the 30s, it reworked once, 1939. You can see he's gone from pure black and white line here to line with color. And then here to pure color with no line in 1954, same motif. And then finally to this very interesting painting in which there's a rift between the upper right, which is again pure line, and the bottom, which is the pure sort of color forms. And I see swing landscape is very much in that sequence, or at least this part of swing landscape very much in that sequence. It's part of it, but it's more than just a part. It's maybe one of the great central terms of his art. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Harry. This like really enhanced my own appreciation for the connections between music and Davis's work. Thank you so much for that really excellent visual analysis.
If we have time, I can place that It Don't Mean a Thing if people want to hear it while they're thinking of questions.
Sure, do you want to play it? And we can think about some questions?
Okay.
It's just a minute or two, right?
Yes. Let's see. I think it's a nice bookend. Okay. That's not the right one. Sorry. Here we go. I'm sorry. Can take some questions while I do this.
Okay. Are there questions for Harry? You can use the hand raise function. I guess I have something of a comment, and then I'll go to you, Greta. I was just thinking while you were talking that one thing we say a lot about swing landscape is how it's this overall composition, and it doesn't really have a beginning or an end or a center. We see it all simultaneously, and the eye keeps moving around. And yet with this musical connection, there's something of an irony in that, because we can only hear music in a linear way. We have to hear the beginning, the middle, the end. I don't know if you had any thoughts about that. That was really just something that struck me. As much as Davis tried to make this connection, there is this little bit of a disconnect.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. And I remember Emily was talking about boundedness of works, or unboundedness, and the swing landscape does seem very unbounded. It's kind of cropped at each side, and you almost want to look at it like a Jasper Johns and see if it wraps around, or if the two sides connect. I mean, one thing about Boogie Woogie is that it has a very hard time ending, and it sometimes goes on and on and on. And I think I think that that's one thing Mondrian liked about it, but it didn't have the beginning, middle, end. And there are, you know, swing pieces that they just want to keep going. And sometimes in live settings, they go on for a very long time. And then there can be a problem of how to end a jazz piece. What do you do? Do you sort of repeat the last four bars three times or something? Or do you hit the cymbal? So I think in some ways it's a little less of a end stopped music than some other forms. But I have come to grief many times trying to make these analogies between the painting and the music, and I sort of avoided anything too specific.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm going to go over to Greta and then Jonathan. Okay, Greta.
First of all, thank you so much. My head is just flooded with sounds and visions and ideas. And as you've said, I've done a lot of work on synesthesia. But first of all, I never associated his sort of nonsense scrawl with scat. And that's perfect. I just love that. But secondly, I wonder whether there are some letters that seem to be in the center of swing landscape. It's like a T and an H, but I'm not sure. And then in a previous one that you showed, there are the words S-E-I-N, which would be the beginnings of the Seine River. So right. I'm right. Wondering if this...
They're in the middle of swing... Of American painting, you mean, or tropes to teens?
No, I meant in a study for swing landscape, the last one before you showed swing landscape, where there were the letters S-E-I-N, and then cut off at the end.
Right, so that is Seine, which I believe refers to fishing nets. And the process or the place where fishing nets are repaired, I see some people are nodding their heads to that, although it could very well be, with Davis, it's got to be a pun on his great time in Paris and the River Seine. But you were also saying you saw some letters in American
kind of in home? The middle, no, swing landscape. Oh, in the middle of swing landscape, there's something that might or might not be letters. They look sort of like T and an H. It's in a little orangey place, mm-hmm. kind of smack in the middle. But well, it's one of those things where you're not sure whether it is or isn't letters.
Yeah, I mean, hanging from the top, there's a twist of rope that kind of makes an H.
Maybe that's what it
is. That I haven't found any letters. I mean, there, but he's blurring. I mean, a lot of what he does, I think, is blurring very consciously the line between letter forms and then, you know, symbols, X's, O's, twists of rope. See, to that point where we just start to see abstractly, maybe, if that answers it.
Absolutely, yeah.
So let's go on. I think we can take these two more questions and then take a short break before the panel discussion. So go ahead, Jonathan, if you want to unmute.
Yeah, hi.
Oh, sorry, you got muted again.
Is that my old friend?
I'm afraid it is. Yes, it is.
Lou Elmer, great trombone player.
It's been maybe 50 years since we saw each other. But it's great to see you and to hear you talk about this stuff. I wanted you to say just a couple words about why you think, and if there's a record, actually why Stuart Davis liked the Earl Hines piano performance in the Armstrong that you played. Because it demonstrates another thing that jazz tends to do. I thought Stuart Davis's account of how jazz takes melody and abstracts from it very actually quite accurate. But the Heinz is really remarkable for a desire to sort of squeeze as much into the 8 bars that he has that you possibly can, which also seems a very Stuart Davis kind of attitude in this particular mural. So just whatever you want to say about that.
That's what I want to say. Really, I think he uses the whole keyboard. He gets in is it 16th notes, maybe even faster. It's virtuoso, has classical elements in some ways, not especially swinging, but I think Davis he talks about mathematics and the sort of numerical aspects of this kind of playing, and I think he's very taken with that that complexity and the fullness. Exactly what you were saying. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll take one more question from Chloe.
Hello, everyone. I'm an alumni of IU's Art History Program undergrad, and I will be attending Georgetown's Art and Museums Master's Program in the fall. So I have a question. I'm wondering about, was he specifically bound to the nightlife of New York City? I wonder, because if you look at the dates of a lot of these paintings, it's like specifically like 1938. And in my knowledge, that's like the same year that Hitler had the degenerate art exhibition in Germany. At that same time, people who I'm really interested in, like Frida Kahlo and Diego Rivera, they were making art specifically about, or not specifically, but influenced heavily by their interest in the leftist movements that were happening. But it seems like he, while based on his journals, was really interested in leftism and the people. He was focused on music, which seems kind of irrelevant when a war is about to happen. Mm-hmm. And so I'm interested in, was he really just like, oh, New York is just like the best place ever, and I'm really interested in what's happening right here, right now. Whereas it seems like other artists at this time were looking internationally.
Probably a few of us could take that, but I think that a place like the Cafe Society that we heard about, and Davis really started to go out. He met John Hammond in 1940, so after the Spirituals to Swing concerts, and Hammond started introducing him to musicians, and he started speaking like jazz lingo and putting it in his paintings and going out a lot more. But the Cafe Society was a gathering place, really international gathering place for all kinds of people, of intellectuals and artists, Paul Rooks and Eleanor Roosevelt, Billie Holiday, and all kinds of emigres, expats. I mean, people, of course, had met so many people who left Europe, fled Europe to New York. New York kind of was international. I guess that's how I would answer that. And Davis, he totally rejected any kind of regionalism or Americanism, American scene, really kept thinking about Europe and in terms of art and politics. Anybody wants to?
Yeah, I'll just I can answer another part of your question. I made this point in the exhibition catalog. Davis was actually he was painting swing landscape throughout 1937. And it was that summer that the Degenerate Art Show opened in Germany. It was still traveling around Germany in 1938, as you point out. He was very much aware of that, and he actually wrote an essay. I don't think he published it, but he wrote a very, almost a very emotional essay about the suppression of modern art and human rights in Nazi Germany. And he was, I think, very, very aware that the kinds of art forms that he was working in and promoting would be considered degenerate in Germany. So he definitely had that international perspective and, you know, connected to politics. I'm going to unmute Greta because I think she wants to say something.
Yes, I was going to say that the idea that somebody is involved in music does not mean that they're not aware of what's happening in the world. And it's partially an escape, and it's partially the way in which somebody can express, I mean, pretty much what you just said, Jenny, the way in which he can express what he feels about the situation. He did not feel that it was appropriate to do it in a social realist way, but he did it by changing, doing new techniques, doing things that are modern, doing things that are aware, bringing together people, using jazz, all of these things. It doesn't mean that he thought this was just great and everything was fine at all.
I'm going to mention a comment in the chat too from Sarah Humphreyville, who also just wanted to point out that, you know, Davis is very involved in political and artistic organizations in the 30s, including the American Artists Congress and Art Front. And the time that he devoted to that activity actually took him away from art too. So that's, you know, an interesting point. So we can take one more quick comment or question from Karen Wilkin, and then I think we will need to stop just so we have a brief break before the panel discussion. Okay, Karen, you can go ahead and unmute. You should be able to unmute.
Yeah, okay. Got it. Very briefly, as was just said, Davis was a very committed activist during the 30s. He virtually did not paint. He mostly drew. He always claimed that he broke with his close friend Gorky because Gorky only wanted to play, by which he meant staying in the studio, although they continued to be close. But Davis did not believe that the way to deal with social problems was through his art. He wrote, and I'm paraphrasing here a bit, that, you know, too much is asked of art, that it solve all kinds of problems that nobody can solve. And that it was, then he talks about it as a formal arrangement. So his commitment was very deep, but it was, he felt you had to do something much more active than do it through your painting.
Okay. Thank you, Karen. So at this point, let's just take a break for about 7 minutes and we'll come back at 3:30 with all of our panelists and moderators for a panel discussion. And thank you again, Harry.